Today is Thursday, July 7th, 2016, and this is the beginning of the interview with Miss Murray at Marion County Public Library in Ocala, Florida. Miss Murray is 75 years old. My name is Samuel Kwiatkowski, and I will be the interviewer. Miss Murray, as some background, could you state for the recording your full name, address, and date of birth?
My name is Sharon Miller Murray. My birth date is November 30th, 1940, and my address is Ocala, Florida, 34472.
Where were you born?
Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Who were your parents? What were their occupations?
My father, George Miller, was a carpenter, and my mother was a homemaker. Her name was Unity, U-N-I-T-E-Y, Miller.
Did you have any siblings?
Yes, I have two. A younger brother, 3 years younger, who is William Keith Miller, and a younger sister, whose name is Unity, spelled the same way, Rosalian Miller. Her name now is Unity Cole.
Did either of them serve in the service?
No.
Neither of them served? What were you doing before you entered the service?
I entered the service out of college. I graduated from college in 1962 and spent the summer on crutches because I had hurt my knee doing the twist right before I graduated. And then I had already decided to go to officer training school, and so I went into officer training school on November 9th, 1962.
What branch of service did you serve in?
Air Force.
Did you enlist or were you drafted?
Women have never been drafted into the military. And the Air Force in those days didn't take any draftees. I enlisted.
Since you enlisted, why did you choose the Air Force?
Well, I didn't know what I wanted to do when I graduated from college. And I had friends from college who were in Air Force ROTC and who were going into the Air Force. And I said to one of them one day, what would I do? And he said, well, you could be a recruiter, because I had done recruiting for my college sorority. And I thought, well, that might be interesting. And so an Air Force recruiter was on our campus a couple of days after that. And this is a true but very frivolous reason. I like blue.
That's nice. What happened when you departed from training?
When I finished with my training, I got an Air Force specialty code of information officer, and I went to an Air Force Reserve sector in Long Beach, California. I worked on the airport there in a very small organization.
Do you recall your instructors and what they were like?
Oh, in officer training school? Mm-hmm. Sure. They were intelligent. Some of them were good teachers. Some of them weren't so good teachers. I thought my WAF training officer, women in the Air Force is what they called us then, was sophisticated and attractive. And she was trying to teach us to be able to be in an organization which was full of men and be able to hold our own, to be respected, and to feel comfortable in that organization. And I thought she did a very good job. There were 885 people in my class. And my rank was 32. As a result of that, I was offered a regular commission in the Air Force.
Did you receive any special training, or was your training just like the guys?
In those days, we were part of a class of men. We went to all the academic courses together, and we had separate physical training. Women didn't carry weapons in those days, and so while the men were taught to shoot, we didn't handle guns. I didn't ever fire a weapon. Well, I did, but I was never taught to fire a weapon until I was going to Vietnam, and in those days, women had to qualify, everybody had to qualify with an M16 before they went over to Vietnam. But after I went to my first assignment, I was sent to Boston University to the Graduate School of Public Communications to get further training in public information. It was a nice assignment. I was there in Boston in the fall when all the foliage was changing, and we lived in a hotel that was near the campus. And I learned things that I've used today.
How did you adapt to the military life?
Since it was totally new, I just did what was expected of me. I enjoyed it. I was accustomed to doing well academically, and in officer training, part of it, most of it for us, was academics. And that worked. In my first job, I was very inexperienced. I don't know how well they adapted to my being there, but I learned things that I needed to learn. I made friends in the community. There were no other young officers in the organization that I was in, but there were 181 ships home-based in Long Beach at the time. And so there were a lot of military people in the community, a lot of us about the same age, and all of us away from home, and there was no war going on then. And so I adapted all right. I never intended to make it a career. I just kept staying in.
Where did you serve?
Well, first I was in Long Beach, California. And I wanted to go on recruiting duty. So I worked with some of the local recruiters in California, and they encouraged me to submit an application for recruiting duty. I did. And I was assigned to Stewart Air Force Base, New York, which is 30 miles over the mountain from West Point. While I was recruiting at Stewart Air Force Base, a really good assignment. I had a lot of fun. I felt as though I helped women who didn't know what they wanted to do find places where they could further their interests in different fields in the military. And I made a lot of friends in the area, and I met my husband. Well, when I married him, he had orders to go to Vietnam. At that time, they were sending a lot of draftees. The war became really public in 1964 when I was still in Long Beach, and some of my friends were on a Navy ship that was attacked in the harbor. And so from that day, we were all aware of the war, even if we weren't there. My husband had been teaching at West Point, so he hadn't gone to war yet when I met him. And I thought, well, they're drafting a lot of people and sending them to war. And women were not combatants, but a lot of people who went to Vietnam were not combatants. And I thought I could do a job just as well as somebody else who may have had to go there twice. Because I didn't go once, so I volunteered for Vietnam. That was December of 1967. We left in mid-June of 1967. We weren't stationed in the same place, but we went over on the same plane and then came home in July. Did I say 1967? We were married in December 67. We went to Vietnam in June of 68. And came back in June of 69. Well, at that time, my husband had gotten a PhD before he went over. He needed a utilization tour, they call it, for the PhD. If you haven't get an advanced degree while you're in the service and the service pays for it, and they're expected to assign you to some kind of a place where you use that understanding. And there aren't a lot of places except schools where a PhD in chemistry is going to be, where you can really use it. So they And they wanted me to have a command. The Air Force wanted me to have a command. So I was assigned as the WAF commander at Travis Air Force Base. And my husband was assigned to Lawrence Livermore Laboratory in Livermore, California. And we lived halfway in between. Well, I was at Travis for 3 years. And he was told that he needed to go on another remote tour. And, you know, a remote tour means that you're going somewhere without your family. It didn't have to be combat, it had to be remote, though, because he had only had one remote tour, and a lot of Army people were going to war a lot and going on remote tours a lot. That wasn't true in the Air Force. So I said, well, I'd like to go, but I don't want to go back to war. One war in a lifetime is enough for me. So we decided that if they could find a place for us, we would go to Korea. And he had a command just north of Seoul at Camp Red Cloud. And I was assigned to a fighter base 3.5 hours south of Seoul at Kunsan. I was there for a year. And then that was a normal tour. And then the Air Force decided they wanted to send me to graduate school. I applied for graduate school to get an MBA at the University of Kansas because I knew my husband was coming back from Korea to go to an intermediate staff college at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. So I went to the University of Kansas. From there, he stayed on the faculty at Fort Leavenworth. And I was assigned to Richards Kabauer Air Force Base in Missouri, which was just a 30-minute drive away from where I'd been living while I attended the University of Kansas. And I was the director of information for a major Air Force command, Air Force Communications Service at that time. Let's see, what happened after that? Okay. I was coming close to the end of my tour there. It was a 3-year tour. And my husband was coming close to the end of his tour. And the Army talked to him about going to Washington, D.C. And they also talked to the Air Force, so I got a call from the Air Force that said, did I want to go to Washington? And I was to be the Air Force Privacy Act officer, and I said I would do that because we had a baby by this time, and it helps if you can be in the same place if you have a baby. So we planned that, but I got a call right before we left Kansas, or Missouri. We had moved to Missouri then, but the same general location. If I would be a volunteer for a study of the Air Secretariat. This is all the offices that work for the Secretary of the Air Force. And in the service, if you're asked if you want to volunteer for something, they usually expect you to say yes. But it sounded like an interesting study, doing some things that I thought I knew something about. So I said yes. And the deal was I was to go in to the Pentagon as part of this team, and we would design a system, and we would set the system up. And then I would go back to what my job was supposed to be, or go to my job, the job I was supposed to have, and hire a civilian to run this administrative system in my place. Didn't happen quite that way. We finished the study, and they kept me on to run the system that we had installed. So I was working for the Air Secretariat for 3 years. It was coming to the end of that time, and a classmate of my husband's from West Point was working for the Joint Secretary to the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and he said, will you come down and work in JCS? And I said, I didn't really know if I wanted to do that. But about the same time, I got a call from the Air Force saying they wanted me to go to Holy Cross as a professor of aerospace studies. And I didn't want to do that because I had, again, the baby's still there. She's a little bit older, but she's still there. So I called my friend back and said, yes, I'll come down to JCS. And so I went to the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and I was there for a couple of years, and then I had 20 years in. And my daughter was 9, and I decided I'd like to retire so that I had more time to spend with her. So that's my career.
So Did you ever see combat?
In Vietnam. There was a war going on in Vietnam when I was there in 1968 and 69. Women were not combatants. I was shot at once. I was shot at another time when I was in a helicopter that I probably should not have been in, but I had gone up to visit my husband at the base camp where he was, and I was coming back, and we drew fire. I didn't ever have to fire a weapon. The second time I was thinking about if something happened to the man who was sitting beside me, how well I could handle the M16 that he had, but it didn't happen, so no. There are a lot of people in war who aren't combatants. They're in combat. They're subject to rocket attacks and all kinds of other things. We had more than our share of rocket attacks at Tonson Newt Air Base, but they're not in hand-to-hand combat. That's the difference.
So you obviously met your husband while in the service. Did you form any other big friendships while you were serving?
Oh, sure. You become friends with people in every assignment. It sometimes is hard to keep up with them if you're in a 20 or a 30-year career. You make so many friends. You only have a certain amount of time in a day. And yes, I have... a particular friend of mine is my roommate from officer training school, who was also, by the way, in Vietnam at the same time I was. And a lot of our friends now are people that my husband went to school with. Because if you go to a regular college, people go off and do lots of different things. If you go to a military school like West Point or Annapolis or the Air Force Academy, you all go into the same company and you see each other in lots of different places over the years. And the bonds become stronger as you get older. And now, I would say a lot of my close friends are the wives of the people that he knew. But we see friends from other assignments often, or somebody will call and say, I'm in town, and, you know, we'll renew that acquaintance.
How did you adjust to civilian life after coming back?
After coming back from Vietnam? Mm-hmm. I wasn't a civilian, remember. By this time I was a WAF commander. But those were the years when there were lots of protests. There were people protesting everywhere, throwing blood on military people, picketing when the planes came back from Vietnam. And I was in Northern California, where a lot of the protests were going on. And my husband, in his job, traveled a lot. Well, I kept a loaded 45 on my nightstand in those days. I adjusted fine. I liked being a civilian. We lived off base, of course. I had military friends and civilian friends, and it was kind of a pleasant time. But I was a little bit afraid when he wasn't there. In fact, there's a funny story. One time he was TDY, temporary duty, which meant he had to go out of town on business, and he was supposed to come back in the morning. Instead, the last meeting of the day ended early, and he caught a flight back to San Francisco. And the flight got in about 10 o'clock. Well, I had long days, and I was an early riser, and I went to bed early, so it's maybe 10:30, and the phone rang, and I picked it up. Whoa, and he said, Sharon, it's Bill. I'm coming home tonight. I'm at the airport. I'll be home in an hour and a half. I can't remember how much time. I said, okay. He said, Sharon, unload the 45. I said, okay. He said, Sharon, unload the 45. I'm going to stay on the phone until you unload the 45. So I did. Because I wasn't worried about anything in my house, but we lived in a little house, and I could hit almost anything in the doorway with my 45, and I felt perfectly safe when I had it there. He didn't feel as safe.
So you weren't, as a Vietnam vet, you weren't received well by the community?
people didn't understand. Some civilians didn't understand why I was in the war, but usually the people who didn't understand didn't become friends of mine. You know, I knew pacifists, and we were polite to each other, and I didn't have, I guess I was lucky, or maybe I just didn't notice. You know, I knew that it was an unpopular war. I went because I felt it was my duty to go. I came home. I had my job in the military, and I just went on with my life. Now, there was a time when I had to be escorted into the Pentagon by a bunch of police because they were picketing the Pentagon. This is years later, and they had thrown blood on somebody. So when I got out of my car in a uniform, I was surrounded by all these policemen and the security detail from the Pentagon. And they escorted me from my car through all the protesters to go into the building.
Were you received well by your family? And your family didn't?
They were just so delighted I was home. I'm not sure anybody received it well when I said I was volunteering for Vietnam. My mother was upset, but you know, I think young people aren't aware of how their parents worry about them. I thought it was wonderful that I was volunteering to go with my husband when he went overseas. And my mother was just really upset, and so was my sister. And I was completely oblivious to that. But I recently saw a picture that was taken the day we were leaving. We were going on leave to go to Vietnam. My sister, who was 15, was sitting in a chair, just looking awful, frowning. My mother was fooling around, and she was wearing Bill's hat. But my sister embodied the feeling that people who love military folks have when they go overseas. Nobody who loves you wants to hold you back, but nobody really wants you to go because they want you to stay where it's safe. And they don't want to get in the middle of you and what you feel you need to do to serve your country, but they don't like it much. It's like the first time you went, your mother's feeling the first time you went to scout camp. You know, you worry about your children, doesn't matter how old they are. And I didn't have any idea how young and naive I was when I went off to war.
So how did your wartime experiences affect your life after you returned?
I hate standing in line when it's hot. I never will stand in line out in the heat. I don't care what somebody wants me to do. I hate it because in Vietnam, you're always in line waiting for something and it's always hot. Or for us, you never got clean, you never got cool. We lived in, my husband lived in a tent, but on Tan Sanut, we lived in small rooms, a little bit, I don't know, my room wasn't a lot bigger than this room. But up, I guess at about the, it was, had an 8-foot ceiling, and at about the 6.5 foot, 7 foot, it was screen and a fan. You know, it didn't have walls. There was just, there was moving air. It was certainly livable, but I wouldn't call it comfortable. And so one of the things that, let's see, the things I don't like as a result of Vietnam. Standing in line. Oh, when I was in a helicopter that was shot at, I kept my cool, and we landed in Hotel 3, which is where I was going, and I got off, and my knees buckled a little bit going across the parking lot. You're not aware that you're afraid when you're doing something. You're either afraid before or you're afraid after, but you don't have time to be afraid if you're involved in something. And I really didn't think any more about it. My husband is a pilot of a light plane, and we were going down from Northern California, where we lived in Concord, to Monterey, where a friend of ours from Vietnam was stationed. That part of California is lovely. It's forested. California has the old hills, so they're very steep. It's all very beautiful. But the greenery, the dense greenery, the trees was like Vietnam. And when you're in a light plane and you're going to land, you do what's called slipping. You just kind of turn the engine off and coast down a little bit to get yourself. I was petrified. Petrified. And it brought back the memory of having been shot at in the chopper in Vietnam. And so I guess if that's a war experience, that's one of the things that was negative. But after a while, that didn't bother me either. I was lucky. I went, I came home. If there was psychological damage, it was slight, and I got over it. But I wasn't in combat either. We were rocketed often at Tonsonut in the year I was there. But you could hear the rockets coming in, and you could tell the difference between outgoing rockets and incoming rockets after a while. It was just a different sound. And so it was a big base, and you just didn't worry about it. I had my bed up on bricks, and I had my flak vest and a helmet under the bed, and my radio. I had the radio right on the edge of the bed. So if the rocket siren would go off at night, I would just roll out of bed and roll under the bed and slip on. I had a shirt, a long sleeve shirt inside the flak vest. So I would just slip that on and make sure my radio was on and go back to sleep, because there wasn't really very much you could do. They had a bunker that we could run to, but I'm not running around in my nightgown outside if there are rockets coming. In my opinion, that wasn't the smartest way to do things. And so I would just roll under the bed and go back to sleep. We didn't get big volleys of rockets at Tonsonut. You might have one or two in the area where you were, but you would still stay under there until there was an all clear sound.
What were some of the life lessons you learned during your military service?
Oh, life lessons? Put first things first. These are all cliches, but lessons. Winners never quit, and quitters never win. Nothing in war has intrinsic value. It matters what the usefulness of that item is. What else did I learn? I learned that women managers should not raise their voices. Because if you're managing men and you raise your voice, they turn it off because they think you sound like their mothers. Women managers are far more effective at managing men when they lower their voices if they're angry. What are their life lessons that I learned? Be kind. There's no reason not to be. Smile at people whom you meet. You don't know what kind of a day they're having. And you can make their whole day better because you smile at them. These aren't the kind of life lessons everybody learns, but you asked about the ones that I remember. The Air Force sent me to graduate school to get an MBA, and I was a philosophy and English major in college, so I learned an awful lot about organizational design and management in the military. I learned a whole lot about leadership. What happens today, as a result of all of that, is that I'm often asked to be the president of a board. If I join a board, they asked me to be the president. Pretty quickly, they asked me to write things that need to be written, because you have to learn to write if you're an officer in the military most of the time when you express your opinions about things. The person who can make the decision about whether something is done isn't your immediate boss, it's somebody at a higher level. I worked in the Pentagon for a long time, and I saw how the Joint Chiefs of Staff made decisions, and I saw the organization that went into dealing with that. I'm basically a disorganized person, but I learned how to put organization around my natural tendency to be a flake. But now, other people you interview will have spent 4 years or so in the military, or 2 years. They haven't had, didn't have as much time to learn life lessons as I learned. I learned to look at what your boss is trying, if you want to be successful, look at what your boss is trying to do and try to figure out how best to help your boss do it. Not figure out how best to do your job, because your job always, you learned this in Scouts, your job always fits in to what other people are doing to make something good happen. And I learned to relate to all different kinds of people and to be supportive. I learned that it's really a bad idea to try to get ahead on the shoulders of somebody else, although that's something that happens everywhere. There are people who are trying to do that. It's not the right way to be, and it isn't, and you don't do as well as if you try to nurture the people who are your employees. What else did I learn? You don't really want me to go on and on and on about my life lessons, but those are some of the kinds of things that I think are important. And nobody ever asked me that question. Thank you.
No problem. What message would you like to leave for future generations who will hear and see this video?
I passed body bags on my way to work in Vietnam. Full body bag. Abraham Lincoln said, and I can't remember the exact words anymore, "We need to make sure that these honored dead shall not have died in vain, that from these people we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave their last full measure of devotion." It's true that this is the home of the free because of the brave. It's true that the military is supposed to support the values that the country was founded on. We have an obligation, we who are here now, and our children and our grandchildren, to foster those values so that we keep the freedom that all of these folks have died to achieve for us.
Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you. If I had known you were going to do this, I would not have come here. I have been asked so many times to share my Vietnam experiences. Have this in, we're going to publish this book, because women didn't, now the camera's off, women didn't,